Good morning. I want to welcome especially our visitors that have not been with us before on Facebook Live to the Boiling Springs Church of Christ worship service this morning, and to all of our members, we miss you and cannot wait to get back together soon. Have a few announcements before Daniel leads us in our song service. If you have any announcements, please send those to the elders or myself or Susie, so we have we can announce that. If you need communion cups, they are here on Susie's desk. You're welcome to come by and get those. And please continue to call and check on our shut-ins and elderly members. We'd appreciate that. I want to give a little bit of thanks to some people this week. I want to thank Elton and Elton Jr. for their hard work on installing a new computer and software so we can, so our Facebook Live will function better in the future. We really appreciate their hard work. And also Dan Turner and his crew worked hard addressing our drainage issue in our playground area, and we greatly appreciate all his efforts there. There will also be some volunteers that will go to the Walford's house tomorrow, Lord willing, to install a ramp for Jonathan for a wheelchair, and we appreciate everyone that's helping with that. Please continue to remember the sick of our number as you see it on Facebook and through calling people. And also a reminder that Charles' class will start 10 minutes after our worship service this morning, and you should get notification of that. And also, if please keep in mind your contribution. We have several means of getting that to us. If you need us to come pick it up, we'll be happy to do that as well. And appreciate Jay Weaver setting up so many options there. And at this time, let's go to God in prayer as we begin our worship service. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we have been so blessed. We thank you for being with us during this time. We pray for the world over with the virus and be with those that are sick. We pray that they would recover. We're so thankful for the doctors, nurses, and everyone, and pray that you will put your healing hand on those that are affected at this time. Father, we're thankful for your church that your son died for, that we have the privilege of worshiping you this day. We pray that everything we do, Father, will be in accordance with your will, that we will remove the things of the world from our mind and concentrate on the words that we're singing, and be with Michael as he distribute your word today, that we'll take it into our hearts and minds and apply it to our lives. We love you so much, and thank you for loving us first. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Number 669. Number 669, This Is My Father's World. This is my...
This do in remembrance of me. In the book of Acts, the chapter is 20, verse number 7. Upon the first day of the week, disciples came together to break bread. And over in Matthew 26, in verse number 26, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body. Let us give thanks for the bread. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this precious bread that represents the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remissions of sin. Let's give thanks for the cup. Our Father, once again, we thank you for this cup that represents the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Set aside for our collection we're also commanded to give, not grudgingly, not out of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Let's go to our Father in prayer. Our Father in heaven, once again, we come to you realizing that you knoweth all things and that you have all power and it's in your hand. We're so thankful for the life that we live because of you. We thank you for all the extra necessities that you've allowed us to have. And we ask you to bless those who are less fortunate at this time. We thank you for our jobs and our homes and our families and even the food that we eat. We pray at this time that we will give back accordingly to your scripture. That we'd be cheerful givers, and not only in monies, but in our love and support to help others. We come now and pray in this prayer through your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Number 970.
For the times, farther along will know all about it, farther along will understand why. I hope that in this time that we are facing as a nation and as a world, that you are finding blessings in this. Every cloud has a silver lining. Every occasion that we face as children of God can be a curse or a blessing, depending on what we do with it. And I hope and I pray that you are finding a blessing in the situation that you may find yourself at this time. I know one blessing that many are able to receive is more family time. And I hope that that's something that you consider as a blessing. I hope that you enjoy being with your family. And if you don't, then here's a good opportunity to work on that
and do the things that are needed to be done to make your home and your family time enjoyable and a blessing, and so that within itself becomes a blessing. In Philippians chapter 4, we'll read verses 1 through 7, and I want us to focus on a couple of verses here, but let's get the context. Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. We read, "Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Euodias and I beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and by supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." As Paul appeals to the church at Philippi, again, we see, as we do throughout the book, we see that emotional appeal to them, that emotional bond that he had with this church. They were very special to him. This was a congregation that he started while he was in Philippi, and he has worked with them, and they have been fellow laborers with him through the years. Paul realizes that maybe there are some personalities within the church that need to be reminded that we are to be of the same mind. He told the church at Corinth the same thing in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, to be of the same mind, the same understanding. And we as the Lord's church need to seek to be of the same mind, the same understanding. Now, how do we do that? We do that by putting aside our personal preferences and our opinions and our prejudices and focusing on the Word of God and seeking to be who God would have us to be. That is why I would encourage all of us to always go to the Word of God, seeking to be changed, seeking to find what God's will is for us in our life, and praying that He will change us through that. Quite often when people are confronted with the truth of the Word of God, they recoil to that because they don't want to change. We ought to approach God's Word with a desire to change. For none of us have reached a point to where we don't need to change. And so, Paul addresses the church here, and he addresses these laborers in the gospel with him, and he says, "You, right now you need to focus on being of the same mind." As we are primarily getting most of our communication through social media now, there's a lot of bickering I see, and actually I don't see so much of the negative comments as I do the response to the negative comments. I think sometimes the cure is indeed worse than the problem. But what we need to be reminded of is that we are to be of the same mind. We are to seek to follow the Word of God to the very best of our ability and to encourage our brothers and sisters as we strive together to do this. And so then we can do, as Paul says here, stand fast in the Lord. Stand fast. Stand strong. In my mind, I envision a troop of soldiers who are advancing upon the enemy, and their leader is calling out to them, those on the front line, stand fast, stand fast, stand fast. The enemy is approaching, but you must stand fast. Together we face a common enemy, and that common enemy is Satan. And he is all over this world. He has his fingerprints all over it, and he controls so many in it. with the sin and the lust and the pride that compels people to act the way that they do. But we have a Savior. We have a message from God to take to the world, to bring them to the Savior. And thus, we engage Satan on a daily basis as we approach him on his territory. You see, we're not in retreat. The Christian armor has nothing for the backside, because there is never a time when we retreat from our enemy. Always pressing forward, always moving on. Stand fast in the Lord. It may be that at home right now that you're wondering where your next paycheck is going to come from. You're wondering if you're going to have a job. Maybe you've lost your job. Maybe you're dealing with some problems at home, and things are hard and things are tough and there's a lot of friction. That maybe you're in a situation where depression is something that you struggle with, and that's really closing in on you now because you're hearing so much and there's so much that you don't know and can't control. And whatever your situation may be, I want to encourage you to take to heart the Word of God here and stand fast, stand fast, stand strong. Folks, we need trials, and this is to some extent a trial. There are many throughout history who have faced much worse. There are many in other areas of the world that face much worse on a daily basis. It's time for us to stand up and to stand strong and to stand fast. I'd suggest that if there are those influences that are causing you to waver, to lose your faith, to worry too much, to have too much fear, then get rid of those influences. If it's the TV, you have a remote, turn it off. If it is certain people on social media, unfollow them. If that doesn't work, unfriend them. If that doesn't work, block them. I have no problem whatsoever doing that to someone who is causing me to struggle in my faith, whether it be on social media or in real life. We need to focus on what is good, focus on what is right, focus on what is pure, focus on the things that build us up and help us to stand fast in the faith and to be who we need to be as soldiers of Christ. Now is not the time to retreat. Now is not the time to lay down. Now is not the time to camp at the enemy's fire. Today is the day that we engage in battle. And we are soldiers of Christ. That never stops. From that, we never rest. It is time for us to gird up our armor and get to work in the battle that is the Lord's. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 through 15. Who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you of a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. What does that mean? That means I set aside my heart for God, that God rules my heart. And when I sanctify my heart for God, or I sanctify God in my heart, there's no room for anything else there. It's all God. And so doubt and fear and anger and pride and lust and envy and all of those things, they have no room in my heart. My heart is full of God. Is your heart full of God right now? When we do this, if we sanctify the Lord God in your heart, then there is a surety, there is a security, there is a steadfastness. Then we can be ready always to give an answer for the reason that is hope within you. Even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you're blessed. We are too blessed to complain. We are too blessed to focus on the negative. We are too blessed to worry about tomorrow. We're just too blessed. And I'm not even talking about the physical things here. There's so much better, there's so much more in a Christian's life than that which is physical. We are to be of the same mind, as we mentioned in Philippians chapter 2, verses 2 through 4. Again, as Paul has written to the church at Philippi, he says, "Fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but for the interest of others." Now is a good time to be focusing on looking for the interest of others, making those phone calls, writing those cards, sending those emails, those texts, checking up on social media. Well, however it might be that you can communicate with people, to check up on them and look out for each other. In 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10, as we mentioned earlier, Paul writes, "Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment." So how are we going to do that? How in the world can we all be perfectly joined together in the same mind and the same judgment? Somebody says that's impossible. I mean, you look at the religious world today and you see hundreds upon hundreds of different denominations and variations of denominations and churches that are community churches, and you go on and on and on. You can drive down a street, take one street in Spartanburg County and start driving and stop at every church building on that street each Sunday, a different church building, and listen to the sermon. And if you were to hear the sermon on the same subject, you would hear many different variations, many different takes, many different doctrines on that same subject, on that same verse. How in the world can we be of the same mind? There is one way and only one way that we can be of the same mind, but we can do it. It can happen. The only way that it can happen is that we all agree that we're going to put aside our own personal opinions, our own ideas, our own traditions, our catechisms, our councils, our creeds, everything that comes from everything that man has written goes out the window. Everything that comes from man goes, and the only thing that we focus on is what God has written. When we do that, we can start to find a way to be of the same mind and of the same spirit. Then and only then. You see, God's word doesn't divide. God's word unites. It's man that divides. And Paul, writing through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, makes a plea. "I plead with you, brethren, in the name of our Lord, that you speak the same thing and that there be no divisions among you." I want you to think about that. That there be no divisions among you. What was the plan that the Lord had in place when he established his church? You remember what he told Peter and the apostles in Matthew 16, "Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it." Jesus said, "I will build my church." One builder, and it belongs to him, and he built one church. That's why in Ephesians chapter 4, we read that there's one Lord, one faith, one body. There's only one. And somebody said, well, yeah, but that's the body that is made up of all the different denominations. How can that be? When the Bible pleads with us to speak the same thing and be of the same mind and let there be no divisions among you. You know, as a gospel preacher, if I preach one thing and another preacher preaches another thing, one or both of us have got to be wrong. He can't be right and I'm right too. If he's right, I'm wrong. Now, we can both be wrong, but we can't both be right if we're teaching different things about what God has said. That's division. That is not being of the same mind. That is not having the same understanding. So the restoration plea was very simple. It was, hey, folks, let's put away our denominations. Let's put away our creeds. Let's just open the Bible and be New Testament Christians. That's pretty simple. It's beautiful. One of the beautiful things about what the Lord established with His church is the simplicity of it. It's so simple. Man has complicated it. Man has created so many different variations and complications. When you go to the scriptures, it's so simple. Why can't we just simply be New Testament Christians? Why hyphenate? Why be this kind of Christian or that kind of Christian when in the Bible we only find one kind of Christian? Let's be that. Be of the same mind. And then rejoice in the Lord. And I love this. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Listen, when Paul wrote this, the church was not having a great time. When Paul wrote this, the church was being persecuted. When Paul wrote this, what they were facing makes what we're facing look extremely light. Rejoice in the Lord always. Paul, what are you talking about? Don't you understand? Things are hard right now. I do. Rejoice in the Lord. Don't you understand that I'm having some family difficulties? Yes, rejoice in the Lord. But don't you understand I might lose my job? Rejoice in the Lord. Why? Because my faith is not in my job. My faith is not in my family. My faith is not in how good the economy is in America at the moment. My faith is in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I will say rejoice. If your faith is in God, and you trust Him to get you through, you can always find reason to rejoice. Rejoice in the time of famine. Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. Though the fig tree may not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, though the labor of the olive may fail, and the fields yield no food, though the flock may be cut from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet to be like deer's feet, and He will make me walk on my high heels. There is nothing that can stand between the Christian and his or her joy in God. The only way something can stand between you and your joy in your God is if you decide to let it. Michael, don't you understand how hard it is? Yes, I do. And so did the Lord. And so did these inspired writers. But that's not the issue. The issue is that I know that regardless of what I face, that God is there with me. He will never leave me. He will never forsake me. And He looks out for me, and He is in control, and He has tomorrow in His hands. And in that, I can rejoice regardless of my circumstance. I can rejoice in the time of famine. And I must rejoice in the time of persecution. When the apostles had been imprisoned and beaten for preaching the word of God, Acts chapter 5, verse 41. So they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for His name. We'll beat those Christians. We'll take the apostles. We'll take the leaders right now, and we'll put them in prison. And if that's not enough, then we'll beat them with the scourge. And they left rejoicing that they were worthy to suffer shame for His name. Listen, if you suffer for the cause of Christ, consider that a blessing. Consider yourself honored to be able to glorify God through your suffering. That I, as weak and feeble and sinful as I am, could be a vessel through which God is glorified? What a reason to rejoice! You see, the world's never understood that. The world's never understood that. They, throughout the years, throughout the ages, time after time again, they thought if we'll just persecute them, if we'll just beat them down, if we'll imprison them, if we'll enslave them, whatever it might be, however we can control them, we'll stomp it out. And you can't, because the more you blow on fire, the hotter it gets. And the scriptures. When Saul and the other Jewish leaders began persecuting the church with a hardship that caused the church to scatter, they ran. They did. They left Jerusalem. Jesus had told them to go into all the world, and they hadn't yet done it. They were stuck in Jerusalem. It took a little persecution to get them to go. But when they went, what did they do? They went everywhere preaching the gospel. You cannot quench the fire that burns in the heart of a child of God. You can rejoice in times of poverty or sorrow. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 4 through 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning with verse 4. But in all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God, in much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watchings, in fastings, by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report as deceivers, and yet true as unknown and yet well-known, as dying, and behold, we live, as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, yet possessing all things. You just can't win against God. He just keeps winning and winning. First Peter chapter 4, verses 12 and 13. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, and when his glory is revealed, you also may be glad with exceeding joy. Here we are, but straying pilgrims. Here our path is often dim. But to cheer us on our journey, still we sing this wayside hymn, yonder over the rolling rivers where the shining mansions lie. Soon will be our home forever, and the smile of the blessed giver gladdens all our longing eyes. Folks, we are not here because this is our home. This is not our home. We're passing through. This is a pilgrimage, and we're going home. Don't forget that. What we face in this life, what trials, what circumstances we must face, build us, prepare us, make us fit for the Master's use, and help us to get home. Don't get caught up in the moment and in the fears of the world. That is not who you are as a child of God. And then Paul writes this in verse 6. Be careful, I believe the King James Version says, be anxious for nothing. Are you anxious? Are you worried? I get that. I mean, after all, we're human, right? But listen, what the Word of God tells us, and what I hope you've gathered from these scriptures that we've shared together today, is that as a child of God, you don't need to be controlled by that. You don't need to let your joy be stolen by that. And what do you do with it? What do you do with it? What do you do with all this worry? What do you do with all this bad news? What do you do with all this gloom and doom that we're hearing every day right now? What do you do? I'll tell you what you do with it. You take it to God and you leave it there. Listen to what the Holy Spirit says through the pen of Paul. In Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. Be careful or be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Did you catch that by thanksgiving part? So here I am, I'm facing hardship, I'm facing possible loss of my retirement, maybe even my job, my income, I'm concerned about my health, and I'm worried, and God says, bring it to me. And be careful about nothing. Don't be anxious about it. Let me have it. And you come to me with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. You know, for most of us, if we're concerned about losing our house, we probably have a whole lot more house than we need. If we're concerned about not being able to make a payment on our vehicles, it may just be that we could stand to lose one or two or three. And we've been so blessed. And we can come to God and we say, you know what, Lord, I don't know what to do with this. And I've got all these wonderful blessings you've blessed me with. I might lose a few of them. And I'm going to bring it to you with thanksgiving that you've blessed me so richly that I've been able to have these things, to have this good job, that I've had a healthy family, or my health has been good, or maybe my health hasn't been good, but I've got good doctors and you've blessed me with good medicine to help me to manage it. Thank you, Lord, for that. Now, I've got this stuff, and I don't know what to do with, but I'm just going to come to you with thanksgiving, and I'm going to turn it over to you, and I'm not going to let it rob me of my joy. Rejoice in the Lord always, through the good times, the bad, through the feast or the famine, through the thick or the thin, through health, through sicknesses, through life and death. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Now, if you're a child of God, you understand that. If you're not a child of God, then maybe you desire that. Because this blessing that we talked about is for children of God. This blessing that we talked about is for those who can come to God and turn it over to Him because they are His and are bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. And if that isn't you, it can be you. You can have that joy. You can have those same blessings. You can have that same peace in God. Just get your life right with Him. Obey Him. Jesus said in Mark chapter 16, verses 15 and 16, it said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. He who believeth not shall be condemned." Now, if you believe Jesus, and you're willing to do what He said, to believe Him and be baptized, why? Acts chapter 2, verse 37, they asked that question. They said, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" The answer came back, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." So baptism in Christ, being immersed in water with Him as we encounter His death, burial, and resurrection, Romans chapter 6, 3 through 5, enables us to have remission of our sins as we receive the precious cleansing of the blood of Jesus. That is why 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21 tells us the light figure whereunto baptism doth also now save you, not the putting away the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. Have you done that? Are you His child? All these blessings that we've talked about, all this peace that passes understanding, all of this rejoicing in the Lord always and being able to put your trust in God. You need that. Would you come to Him, repent of your sins, confess Jesus as the Son of God, be buried with Him in the waters of baptism for the remission of your sins. Listen, I don't care about a quarantine. If you need that and you desire that, we will see to it that you can receive that. If we can study with you, whether it be face-to-face or online or through the phone, or through correspondence course, by email, however we can do it that makes you comfortable, we're here for you. There's nothing more important right now than to be sure that you're right with God. Child of God, are you right with God? It's your faith in Him. If we can pray with you, if we can pray for you, anything that we can do for you, please let it be known. We have people who are manning the computers, and if you have a request to be made through Facebook, just a private message to Bowling Springs Church of Christ, and one of the Altons back there will make sure that we receive that. Would you come? All together, we stand to sing.
Thank you.
And then if there are no more announcements, we'll have our closing prayer.
Let's pray. Lord, we come before you now and we thank you for all the many things you bless us with and all the many things you do for us. And as we come to the close of this service, we thank you for all this modern times and technology where even through these trying times, your people can still come together and worship you. And we ask that as everyone leaves this place, you be with us and keep us safe. In Jesus' name, amen.